Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear reports from Dan Novak and Gregory Stachel. Later, Bryan Lynn presents this week's science report. Finally, we visit a national park made up of 7 islands off the coast of Florida. But first, here is Dan Novak.
Several organizations are racing to save the reef that runs along the Florida Keys. A summer heat wave has already led to historic coral bleaching. Coral bleaching is the process by which coral becomes white because of high water temperatures or pollution. Up and down the islands that form the Florida Keys, coral rescue groups, universities, and the government are working to save the coral. Experts say the bleaching event threatens the health of the third largest reef area in the world. They have been working long days for many weeks to get as much coral as they can onto land. In mid-July, water surface temperatures averaged 33 degrees Celsius off the lower Florida Keys. That is well above the average of 29.5 degrees, says the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, or NOAA. The hot water resulted in nearly 100% bleaching along some parts of the reef. The bleaching caused the corals to lose their zooxanthellae. That is the algae that gives them color and nutrition. If they do not recover their zooxanthellae, they will die. We're already seeing not just bleaching, but actual coral death out on the reef because the temperatures were so hot, said Cynthia Lewis. She is director of the Keys Marine Lab, a research institute on the island of Long Key, about 160 kilometers south of Miami. In Miami, rescue groups have already brought more than 1,500 pieces of coral. Coral bleaching happens naturally when waters warm greatly. It happened in 2016 in the Florida Keys. But Lewis said the current situation is urgent for coral, which is very important to Florida's economy, coastal protection, and marine life. Recent cloudy and rainy days helped lower water temperatures slightly, but it will likely be late October or November before the coral samples can be returned to the reef, Lewis said. The Florida coral reef stretches about 563 kilometers from the Dry Tortugas in the Gulf of Mexico to St. Lucie Inlet, about 185 kilometers north of Miami. The reef is a first line of defense against coastal erosion and flooding from storms, Lewis said. It helps support fishing and the tourism industry. Coral also contains such an amazing amount of diversity and life in the ocean around them, Lewis added. Reef Renewal is a group that has worked to move endangered coral into land-based centers. More recently, the group has worked to save coral in several of their own underwater facilities in shallower water by moving them to deeper, cooler water. Reef Renewal founder Ken Niedermeyer called the coral bleaching hard to watch and hard to experience. He said his group knew that coral stress would increase under climate change, but he and others did not think it would happen so soon. Back at the Keys Marine Lab on Long Key, the collected pieces of coral are put in cooling containers that hold between 40 and 400 gallons of seawater. The 29-degree water makes for much happier coral, said marine biologist Emily Becker. The work goes beyond saving the coral. Becker and others are studying different kinds of coral to see which ones survive temperature stress and disease better. They hope to build a better reef with more resilient corals, she said. Scientists from the University of Miami have created a research site off of Key Biscayne to do such work. Jameson Gove is the co-writer of a new article in Nature about how Hawaii coral reefs survived a 2015 ocean heat wave. The oceanographer said reefs that returned best after Hawaii's heat wave were those that had both the most fish and the least sewage. But he said local efforts will not save reefs if people do not reduce greenhouse gas emissions. I'm Dan Novak.
Baleen whales, such as the blue whale, are huge sea animals. Baleen describes a filter feeding system in their mouths, through which they can eat huge amounts of very small ocean animals. But it appears now that whales were not the first sea animals to filter feed. Scientists recently reported their findings from a study of ancient remains of a sea reptile called Hepatosuchus nonchangensis. The fossils were unearthed in China's Hubei area. The study appeared in the publication BMC Ecology and Evolution. Hepatosuchus lived 248 million years ago, during the Triassic period. Scientists say its fossil presents evidence of a filter feed system similar to baleen whales. The sea reptile lived during a time of intense biological changes following Earth's worst mass extinction. Powerful volcanic bursts led to severe warming, destroying many kinds of life. Unlike blue whales, Hepatosuchus was not large. The animal measured about 1 meter long, fossils show. Its mouth was narrow and toothless. It had a large tail that moved from side to side for swimming forward, and had front and back limbs to help it turn. Its lower jaw was only loosely connected to the rest of the head bone. This permitted the animal to open its mouth widely to take in a large amount of water and the animal's zooplankton it carried. The baleen structure is made up of keratin, a soft organic material. The baleen traps little sea animals, but lets the seawater flow out. The researchers found evidence along the jaws, suggesting the presence of soft tissues that could have served as baleen. Paleontologist Mike Benton was a study writer. Altogether, This points to a soft pouch made of skin around the mouth and throat, as in modern baleen whales, and some kind of filtering device hanging from the jaws, like baleen, Benton said. But he added, the baleen and skin was not fossilized. Paleontologist Long Cheng of the Wuhan Center of China Geological is the study's lead writer. He said Hapesochus would have continuously filter-fed at slow swimming speeds. He also said the animal would have fed in areas with a dense amount of zooplankton. Long said Hapesochus took in water and the animals together into its mouth, filtered out the water, and then swallowed the food. Researchers first described Hapesochus fossils in the 1970s, but lacked any good remains of the head. The new study involves two new fossils with well-kept head bones, or skulls. Many sea creatures use some form of filter feeding. I'm Gregory Stachel.
Scientists have discovered fossils that might have belonged to the heaviest animal in Earth's history. The blue whale holds the current record as the largest creature to live on Earth. But a collection of bones found in Peru might break that record. Researchers recently introduced the whale species in a study in the publication Nature. It is called Perucetus colossus, or the colossal whale from Peru. Each backbone or vertebra weighs more than 100 kilograms. The animal's ribs measure nearly 1.4 meters long. Mario Urbina discovered the bones in 2012. He is with the University of San Marcos's Natural History Museum in Lima. An international team spent years digging them out from the side of a rocky hill in the Ica Desert. The area was once underwater and is known for its rich collection of ocean fossils. The find resulted in 13 backbone vertebrae, 4 ribs, and a hip bone. The large fossils date back to around 39 million years ago. Alberto Colaretta is a paleontologist at Italy's University of Pisa. He was a lead writer of the study. He told the Associated Press, "The fossils were unlike anything I've ever seen." Hans Tavison is a paleontologist at Northeast Ohio Medical University who did not take part in the research. He said, "It's just exciting to see such a giant animal that's so different from anything we know." After the digging operation, the researchers used 3D scanners to study the surface of the bones and also looked inside. The researchers used the huge but incomplete skeleton to estimate the whale's size and weight, said Eli Amson. He is a paleontologist at the State Museum of Natural History in Stuttgart, Germany. The team estimates the ancient creature weighed somewhere between 85 and 340 metric tons. The biggest blue whales found have been within that range at about 180 metric tons. The body of Parasitas colossus stretched about 20 meters long. Blue whales can be longer, with some growing to more than 30 meters. This means the newly discovered whale was possibly the heaviest animal ever, said the University of Pisa's Coloretta. But, he added, it was most likely not the longest animal ever. The research team said one reason the animal weighs more is because its bones are much denser and heavier than a blue whale's bones. Those super dense bones suggest the whale may have spent its time in less deep coastal waters, the scientists said. Other animals that stay close to the coast, like manatees, have heavy bones to help them stay close to the seafloor. Amson from the State Museum of Natural History in Germany said that without the skull, it is hard to know what the whale was eating to support such a huge body. It is possible that the large creature sought food along the seafloor, the researchers said. Or it could have eaten up tons of smaller sea life in the ocean. Tewison added that he would not be surprised if this thing actually fed in a totally different way that we would never imagine. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Now, Bryan Lynn joins me to talk more about this week's science report. Thanks for being here, Bryan.
Of course, Ashley. Thanks for having me.
This week's report dealt with the discovery of fossils that may have belonged to the heaviest animal in Earth's history. Currently, the blue whale is considered the heaviest animal on the planet. How similar is the ancient creature the researchers studied?
So the researchers call the animal Parasitas colossus, and the name describes where the fossils were found in Peru, as well as the creature's massive size. So the team noted that the animal they studied was actually more similar to a manatee than a blue whale, and manatees are known to have large, rounded bodies with smaller heads than whales, and manatees are known to like spending time in warm coastal waters, just like the newly discovered species.
The story notes that the massive creature likely also spent a lot of time in less deep coastal waters. Why did the researchers conclude this?
So the scientists said they're pretty sure Parasitas colossus spent a lot of time in coastal areas because of how dense the animal's bones were, and they added that other animals with very dense and heavy bones can live in coastal areas, and those heavy bones help the animals stay close to the sea floor where they can capture large amounts of food.
Okay, thanks again, Bryan, for taking the time to join me on today's program.
You're welcome. Thank you, Ashley.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. Today, we visit one of the most unusual National Parks in the United States. It is called the Dry Tortugas National Park. It includes 7 small islands. They are about 200 kilometers off the coast of the state of Florida. One of the islands was once a prison. The first European to see the small islands was the Spanish explorer Ponce de León. He arrived by ship in 1513. Ponce de León was an older man who was searching for special water that stories said would make him young again. It was called the Fountain of Youth. Ponce de León named the islands the Tortugas. Tortuga is the Spanish word for turtle. Thousands of turtles lived on the islands. Ponce de León was able to capture many of these creatures to provide meat for his ship's crew. He never did find the Fountain of Youth. In fact, the islands had no fresh water on them at all. The tortugas were dry. The word dry began to appear on early maps of the area to warn ships that they could not find fresh water there. Centuries later, America's third president, Thomas Jefferson, took an interest in the islands. He hoped they could become a place that could help protect ships traveling in a large area of water called the Florida Straits. He proposed a military base be built there. In 1821, the United States took control of Florida and its islands. Construction of a military fort began in 1848, long after Jefferson's death. The fort was to be the home of 1,500 men and 450 huge cannons. The fort's name? Fort Jefferson. Fort Jefferson was never really completed. It had to be worked on continually. The salt air, wind, water, and sand quickly caused problems. The weight of the fort's heavy brick walls made them sink into the sand. Slaves and prisoners did the building and repair work at the fort. Many of the prisoners were army troops. They had been found guilty of crimes and ordered to serve their sentences at Fort Jefferson. In July of 1865, 4 new prisoners arrived at Fort Jefferson. They had been found guilty of taking part in the successful plot to murder the President of the U.S., Abraham Lincoln. One of the prisoners was sentenced for giving medical aid to the man who killed President Lincoln. He was also found guilty of being an active member of the assassination plot. That man was Samuel Alexander Mudd. He was a 32-year-old doctor from the state of Maryland. He was sentenced to spend the rest of his life doing hard labor at Fort Jefferson. The walls at Fort Jefferson were about 15 meters tall. Inside the walls of the fort were hundreds of rooms. Most of them held guns that pointed out to the sea. Many other buildings were also inside the huge fort. No prisoner had ever successfully escaped from Fort Jefferson. It was more than 200 kilometers across open ocean to the nearest occupied land. Samuel Alexander Mudd must have believed the fort would be his home for the rest of his life, but he was wrong. In 1867, Dr. Mudd was helping the prison doctor treat victims of yellow fever. Many people died from yellow fever. Soon, the prison doctor lost his own battle with the disease. Only Dr. Mudd was left to treat the increasing number of men who became sick with yellow fever. Later, the sickness seemed to leave the island. Many of those who survived knew they owed their lives to Dr. Mudd. Almost every man in Fort Jefferson wrote to the President of the United States, asking that Mudd be pardoned because of his work treating patients with yellow fever. They called Mudd a hero. In February of 1869, President Andrew Johnson signed a presidential pardon. Mudd was a free man. He left Fort Jefferson and returned to his home in Maryland. He once again became a family doctor. In 1874, the American Army left Fort Jefferson. Modern artillery made the fort no longer useful. Today, the old fort and empty little islands provide a protected home for thousands of birds, fish, and sea turtles. Visitors travel for hours on high-speed boats that bring them to the islands from Key West, Florida. They swim in the warm waters and enjoy the bright Florida sun. Many try snorkeling or scuba diving to explore the underwater shipwrecks. Still others bring tents and spend a few days living on the white sand beaches. Thousands of visitors make the trip to the Dry Tortugas National Park every year. Of course, soldiers no longer greet them when they arrive at Fort Jefferson. Now, friendly members of the National Park Service do. They meet every boat filled with visitors. They smile and say, "Welcome to Fort Jefferson and the Dry Tortugas National Park." The small island's days as a prison are long past. Yet, almost every visitor to the park asks about its most famous prisoner, Dr. Samuel Alexander Mudd. They ask to see his room. Most people know that the doctor did not end up spending the rest of his life in the Fort Jefferson prison. Only a few of the huge cannons remain at the park. They help show visitors what the old fort looked like. The weather continues to affect the fort's grounds and buildings, so workers continue to fight against environmental damage. The park extends over an area of more than 26,000 hectares. Almost all of this is ocean and living coral reefs that protect the islands. Many ships have sunk in the waters around the islands over the centuries. The wrecks of these ships help provide safe places for many fish. Thousands of kinds of fish live in these waters. Some visitors are even lucky enough to see sea turtles swimming in the clear blue waters. Dry Tortugas is also home to many seabirds. Visitors are not permitted on some of the islands within the park to protect birds that are laying eggs. The striking natural beauty and relaxed feel of the islands today seems far different from Dry Tortugas' earlier history as a lonely, inescapable prison. I'm Ashley Thompson. And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.